the America's Cup, Emirates Team New Zealand wheeled their new 75-foot Defender out of the shed and immediately dropped it into the water and went sailing. The crowd and challengers were astounded. They, in turn, showed their boats and went back into lockdown. Round one to the Defenders. This says, we are ready, are you? It's going to be interesting. This is your weekly Global Sailing Highlights show, The World on Water, April 19, 2024. High on a hill in Greece, they conducted a well-practiced ceremony to light a flame from the rays of the sun. At the time of our editing, it is 100 days until the Paris Olympics. It didn't go without a hitch, but it did combust, and the torch is on its way.
The High Priestess and the Estadia. Is the priestess.
Για τη φιλόξενη πόλη του Παρισιού.
So the sacred flame is alight, and his bridge will be very recognizable.
Remise de la flamme olympique par la grande prêtresse. Έναρξη Ολυμπιακής λαμπαδιδοδρομίας σε λίγα δευτερόλεπτα.
They couldn't resist it, and who could blame them? Emirates Team New Zealand took to the Hauraki Gulf on Sunday in their brand new AC-75 with the sailors itching to get going and push fast through the commissioning phase. No nonsense as always, the day was efficient, despite the team leaving the mainsail inflatable bag that sits between the mainsail skins, back on the dock and having to send a chase boat in to get it. Dan Bonasconi, Chief Technical Officer, Emirates Team New Zealand is interviewed.
Day two for boat three with Team New Zealand on the Hauraki Gulf. Here with Dan Bernasconi, Chief Technical Officer for the team. First full day of sailing, pretty exciting stuff with a few firsts ticked off. How's your day out there?
Yeah, pretty good. Mostly went to plan, not entirely, but I think for day two, not bad all around.
Yep. Is the platform performing how you expected it to?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of actual boat performance, it's very early days. So it's more about looking at the systems, how the sheeting systems are working. Obviously, we got the same foils as last time, so, you know, that's not too much to learn there. So that's mostly about the sails at the moment.
Okay. We noticed there was a little bit of time spent this morning on the dock and out on the water working around the rig with some potential sail controls and hydraulics issues. Is that expected teething issues or something a bit more concerning?
Yeah, a couple of minor things off the dock, and then the main one was we just forgot our airbag. So the mainsail's got an airbag at the top of it, and yeah, we didn't realise we didn't have it till we were all the way out in the back paddock. Yep. So Chase had to go back in and get it. So that was a bit of a cock-up. There'll be some drinks later on from someone.
That's right. These things happen, you know.
Yeah.
The tense day. As you said before, the boat's launched with legacy foils. Do you have a timeline on when the first set of race foils is going to come online? Or?
I'm not going to say exactly when it's going to be, but yeah, I mean, for us, it made sense to launch with the foils from last time because we've only got a relatively short sailing block here in Auckland. And so by delaying the foils until later, it gave us quite a lot more design time without losing too much sailing time. And, you know, I saw that the Lunar Russell have done the same with their boat.
Yeah. Yeah, understood. Little bit of like design question. How aggressive was the design brief for this boat compared to like the last boat or like, you know, is there any areas you held back in or made compromises?
No, I mean, we've always tried to be aggressive.
Yeah.
I guess there's not many people in the team who take a conservative attitude to it. So we all pretty much always have gone all out. And same with this boat. I think, you know, there's a few areas where you have to make compromises and trade-offs. But, you know, ultimately you're always going for the highest performance.
Yeah. We see your boat 3 looks quite considerably different to some of the boats that have already launched. Any comments on Alinghi or Lunarossa?
No, I mean, they're both look like really good boats. Do you want me to hold for the forklift? No,
that's all right. We got the mics. The mics will cut it all out. Yeah, so it's no worries.
I mean, I think you know you can look at their boats and see that they've gone through all the same sorts of questions as we have, and come to slightly different conclusions in some areas. But they're not massively different. There's probably going to be more performance difference in the foils and then in the sails and the way the sails are controlled than there will be in the hull shapes. You know, there are, obviously the aerodynamics of the hull is important, but I suspect all teams have got to within a few seconds of each other around a racetrack. You know, if all other things are equal.
Yeah. Yep. Cool. Do you think that end plating is the big game for in Barcelona, or it's going to be a different story?
Yeah. I think, you know, that's mostly what it's about. It's about sort of creating the most efficient end plate, if you like, for the sails, and sort of extending them down to the water as much as possible. The takeoff is a consideration, and Barcelona is light generally, and the waves don't help. So, you know, both sides of that equation come into play in optimizing the hull shape, the hydrodynamics and the aerodynamics. But generally, I guess everyone's expecting to be foiling most of the time, so the aerodynamics are a bigger consideration.
Yeah. Cool. All right, well, thank you for your time. Hope you enjoyed your day.
All good.
Cheers.
Cheers.
The French legend Penn Duic6, skippered by the indomitable Marie Tabali, has taken provisional line honours in the final leg of the inaugural McIntyre Ocean Globe race, and in the days ahead could potentially win the OGR overall. At 22:52 UTC, on the 11th of April, the stunning Blackholt, 73-foot Bermudan ketch, revered amongst sailors around the world, sailed gracefully across the Royal Yacht Squadron finish line in Cowes, UK. With Marie at the helm, leading her loyal troops, it was fitting that this yacht, sailed by her father Eric Tabali in the 1973 Whitbread Round the World race, should take line honours in such style. With almost a two-day lead on nearest rival Ellisbury Duic6 for line honours, Hen Duic6 dominance on the final leg was unquestionable. The other Corinthian sailing round the world race, the British Clipper race, is currently transiting the North Pacific. It is day 18 of the current leg and the crew on Dare to Lead are feeling tired. The team has entered the low-pressure system coming off of Hawaii. In this report, we hear more about life on board from the crew on Dare to Lead.
So it's day 18 on Dare to Lead and the Hawaiian low finally hit. It wasn't as we expected. It was only sort of 1 to 3 meter swells and kind of 20, 25 knots of wind, which was a bit disappointing. But it's been a lovely day. It's been really sunny, but it is cold, very, very cold.
But yeah, I mean, life on board is amazing. The crew is responding very well, and even though we're tired, you know, the tiredness is taking place, but we're doing well, man. Enjoying it.
Yeah, it's been a really nice day. It's been really clear. Yesterday there was absolutely no clouds. Today, a few clouds, probably 30-40% of the sky, and at the moment it's getting a lot darker. A lot of formation clouds, cumulus clouds coming over. As we're getting more into the low pressure, we're getting more clouds, a little bit more wind. So we're just getting a little bit deeper into this low pressure that's come up from Hawaii. So let's go down and have a look at the time zero, I'll show you. So as you can see, we're currently more than halfway across, which is really exciting. The second half will go quite quickly. As I was talking about now, the low pressure system that we have is we're slightly behind it. So as we get closer to it, it actually is a little bit too fast for us, so it gets away from us. The other boats further north are going to take a lot more of the low pressure. So we're going to get just a mild edge of it, as you can see here. There's a second low pressure system coming in, and we should actually get more of that. It'll give us a nice angle to go up north to join the rest of the fleet. We're the most southern boat at the moment. as we go up, you'll see the second low pressure forming, which is we're gonna get a lot more wind and swell with that, and that should take us all the way up to the ocean sprint. And that's when the whole fleet will kind of compress. So the boats above us now will all rejoin at the beginning of the ocean sprint, and then kind of the last stage in for the ocean sprint and the finish. So looks quite exciting. Some fast sailing the next 4 to 5 days, so we look forward to it.
With new boat launches all around them, New York Yacht Club American Magic stayed true to their program on Tuesday and executed an intense afternoon of two-boat race practice in perfect champagne conditions off a sunny and increasingly warm Barcelona. Team boss Terry Hutchison explains to the official interviewer. We have his subtitles.
We're here in Barcelona with Terry Hutchison, team principal for American Magic. Terry, two-boat sailing today, nice south breeze, messy sea stay. How did it go? What was your focus on today?
Yeah, it was a good day. The Barcelona delivered pretty champagne conditions. A little bit further left than what I think we're normally used to seeing. And, you know, a little bit of cross swell from the east with a Mistral out to the east of us. But all in all, it was a really good day. You know, our focus really since, where are we, in the middle of April, our focus since the middle of March has been two-boat in-house racing and working on that. And I think, I'm not sure how much we did today, but I know we did a lot. We got through two full sets of batteries, so it was a big day for the guys, and you know, we'll look forward to get back at it tomorrow.
Can you give us a quick word about Brandon Linton and his big team up in Cornwall, Rhode Island? Just how immense has the task been of building your new AC-75?
Yes, well, the team in Portsmouth, and you know, led by Brandon, but it is a team. They've done an incredible job to get boat three into the shed here. Yeah, all the teams really. It's exciting to see the new boats coming out. It's exciting to see Team New Zealand sailing down in Auckland, and you know, we see a Lingi sitting in the water over there now, and we saw pictures of their foils earlier, and so you know, this is where. Truly, push comes to shove in this competition. You know, when teams start unveiling their boats and such, but you can't, you know, speak highly enough, really, of our team and the work that everybody in Portsmouth did, and the work that Brandon did to lead that team to deliver us an AC-75. Thank you, Fiona.
Speaking about that, what's the mood against the design team, Red Ward, etc. Now that they have seen the Alinghi Red Bull, Luna Rossa, and Emirates Team New Zealand racing boats, confident or nervous?
I think with all the boats, you have to let everybody come out and you have to do a proper analysis. You know, it's premature to say one over the other. And you know, you really want to take time to be thoughtful in how you look at the boats and make sure we use the same process that we did to develop our boat and apply it to the boats that we're seeing. I mean, you're never going to do it perfectly. So what you can say though is that all the fleet has taken a step on, and you know, it's exciting to this part of the regatta. I mean, it just reminds you that we're not too far off, so it's good.
Now, big question.
Yes.
Where is the America's Cup going to be won? And please don't say on water. What areas of development do you see as a big key?
Well, I mean, the America's Cup is a design competition. And so the fastest boat will win the regatta. And I think all the teams, you know, when you look at it, all the teams will be good and bad across a variety of conditions. And so, you know, I don't really contemplate a lot of, I can only comment about American Magic, and I think for us, you know, why we are working so hard on our racing skills and our racing development is that we have a lot of work to do in that side of our team. You know, there's a vertical curve that will be with us through the end of this regatta, and we saw painfully so firsthand how poorly we sailed in Auckland. And so our goal here is to rectify that situation and put the guys into a position that with a fast enough boat, they can be successful on the water.
If boys can do it, so can girls. This has been proven as the all-female crew brought the classic yacht Maiden, across the McIntyre Ocean Globe Race finishing line in Cowes. Whitbread history was reinvented in Cowes, UK, as Maiden UK crossed the finish line of the McIntyre Ocean Globe Race in suitable style. The sun came out, ABBA tunes blared, and the beers and food were shared around the excited crowds as a carnival festival took over the windy Yachthaven Marina.
Obviously a mix of emotions. There's a lot going on. We had an amazing welcome coming here into Cowes, and which we're really grateful for everyone that came out to see us. I think we're all really happy. I think we really achieved our goal of showcasing what women can do. We always wanted to show women what women can do and inspire the next generation of kids into STEM subjects and into sailing, and I think with the amazing role models we have on the boat, we've really achieved that, and we've done pretty well. The leg itself didn't go so well for us. It probably was our worst leg overall, but we're still really happy, and hopefully we've done enough to get a good result in the end.